All right. Thank you so much for joining us on One-on-One. It is that particular time when we get to talk matters that concern us in different ways. Of course, this is a platform where we get to host various personalities that shape the news agenda in Rwanda, the region, and of course, globally. My guest in studio today is none other than Professor Geoffrey Rugege. Welcome to One-on-One.
Thank you. Yeah. I'm glad to be here.
And it's a pleasure having you on the program today. My name, as always, is Eugene Anangwe. Now, getting into the business of the day, you have just retired as the Council of or for Higher Education Executive Director. And maybe the first question would be, how are you coping with not being in such an institution that vigorously works towards uplifting the standards of higher education in the country?
Let me say to begin with that anything I say here is a personal opinion.
All right. Disclaimer.
I'm sure you always have.
They don't represent my views or the views of any institution that you used to represent.
No. I don't want to be guilty of anything.
Of anything. Good. Uh-huh.
But I'm comfortably retired, but I'm still relatively active mentally, physically. I'm quite dilapidated.
It shows, especially when it comes to the issues of activeness, even on social media. We still see you every time. We see notifications that you've just tweeted about something. You still have the concern about different issues that happen here and, of course, globally.
Of course.
How do you manage to keep up with that, looking at your time and age at this particular time?
Being retired, I mean, it's mandatory to retire in your 70s for a professor. It's not really quite mandatory. You can work longer than that. But Rwanda is a very young country, and they prefer young people to, you know, who are able to run. Most of the officials you find in Rwanda are in their 50s or early 60s, and, you know, to run with them physically would be difficult. But mentally, there's nothing wrong with me yet.
So talking of your retirement, let's go back memory lane and look at your time as one of the people on top of the management of this institution. Do you feel that by the time you are packing your bags and leaving the office in that capacity, do you feel you achieved what you really wanted to achieve?
I don't want to sort of state expectations and things of that kind. When I came here, I had no illusions that I would cause a revolution. But there were some things that needed to be done in the higher education system, especially with the Higher Education Council. Now, I served only 4 years. So there was really not maybe sufficient time to cause a revolution anyway. What was really necessary to do was to make sure that all institutions of higher learning in Rwanda subscribe to the standards that had been set by the Higher Education Council, that had been set by the region, that are recognized internationally, that are internationally credible. I think we went a long way in achieving that. All institutions of higher learning in Rwanda, those that need accreditation are accredited. Now, public institutions are reviewed, but really they are chartered or accredited by the government. So we are not bothered about that. Now, private institutions, on the other hand, have to earn accreditation in order to operate, to continue operating, to open doors, and that is something that we achieved. During my time, all institutions that needed to be accredited were accredited. That was the primary function
at that particular point.
Right.
But then critics have said that look at the quality of citizens that our higher learning institutions are giving when they leave these higher learning institutions, for example, universities, colleges, or various institutions. They have said that our students who are fresh from graduating from these different institutions cannot even write a proper CV, cannot even express themselves in an interview properly, and therefore bringing to some point an accusing finger on either the regulator of these higher institutions, higher learning institutions, or just the system itself. Do you take any responsibility for the fact that during your time, we still had those cases where students fresh from higher learning institutions could not do basic things like writing a proper CV or expressing themselves in an interview?
There are some things that institutions of higher learning or any institution does, right? Now, we're playing catch up in the region. Mm-hmm. That's obvious. We have subscribed to these standards only in the last 15, 20 years. Mm-hmm. But in interviewing, being successful at a job, those kinds of things, they don't teach in a classroom yet. These are sort of tertiary things that you don't teach in a classroom. Now, there are also practical things that students have to have in order to be successful at a job. Mm. Now, remember, there is an assumption that when you leave university, mm-hmm. when you leave college, mm-hmm. you are ready to go to work. Mm-hmm. That is really not correct. Mm-hmm. When you came here to Contact FM, mm-hmm. the things that you've learned here, you didn't learn in school, right? Mm-hmm. Employers can't expect you to know those things first day on the job.
So are you trying to say that employers or those who are saying these things are unfairly accusing these students?
Right. For instance, when I was still teaching mm-hmm. in the United States, mm-hmm. right, my kids, they went to good schools, to the university, right? They were doing computer science and stuff like that, mm-hmm. or scientific stuff, right? But they were recruited by companies to go and do internships mm-hmm. at places like IBM, Microsoft, and other places to get practical training. It is something that we assume can be done here, but because we don't have a large industry, it's very difficult to have internships. So this is something that you should remember. You learn academic stuff and should have practical training as well, internships. Mm-hmm.
So can't we then think, probably from your experience in teaching and also probably looking at these ways of doing things, can't we then think of having a situation where we have these practical skills instilled in these students from these higher learning institutions instead of just waiting for that to happen during the internship process?
The time that you have when you are at the university is just sufficient to complete the curriculum. Mm-hmm. And of course, the people teaching you are not really, don't have the hands-on experience that industry has. Mm-hmm. So that's why, for instance, in other countries, they go to companies like IBM, as I said, Microsoft, GE, you know, those kinds of things, or chemical companies if they are in chemistry, right? And they learn on the job what it is that you're expected to do on the job. So that's really what we need, practical training. Now, another thing that, you know, maybe, you know, is a shortcoming, is that there is an assumption mm-hmm. that all you have to do is to just get a degree. You don't really have to earn it. And then you go into civil service. Because you have that BA or BSc or whatever, whatever you did in college, right, you can get promotions, right? But you need to demonstrate that you can do the job as well. Now, I think there is a question of perception in the public service that as long as you have
a degree, you're fit for the job.
Right.
So this is a wrong assumption that needs to stop.
It has to be worked on. to make sure that people are ready to get into the job market. Mm-hmm. This is why it's so very necessary. And I think one of your, let me jump a little ahead. Mm-hmm. One of your questions refers to the fact, what it is that this country is doing well. Mm-hmm. The emphasis on science, technology, ICT, practical skills as a country. Those things articulated in the Vision 2020, mm-hmm. right? Those are things that we will eventually do well. If we put an emphasis on science, technology, ICT as all-encompassing, mm-hmm. objectives mm-hmm. for the country, mm-hmm. so that people will sort of get oriented in doing things that are going to be practically useful on the job market.
But still, today, some employers are still complaining and saying there is no, we are suffering from the issue of lack of skilled labor when we say we want to employ. Even with this emphasis on this particular areas of study, mm-hmm. there is still that challenge of hands-on approach by those students who come fresh from these universities and colleges. Mm-hmm. And so how do we deal with this then?
Now, I think the best thing those employers should do mm-hmm. is to go to those institutions mm-hmm. and talk to the teachers. Who are the best students in these subjects? In chemistry, in biology, in physics, in agriculture, in medicine, right? I want to take them and train them so that they can see what we do on the job. Mm-hmm. Now, when that is done, then people, when they graduate, they say, okay, I know how to cut things with a knife mm-hmm. in a surgical ward. Mm-hmm. I know how to plant seeds and make sure
that... Because there's a company that took me and showed me how
right.
to do that.
So, for instance, a company like Nyangarama, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Which produces juice mm-hmm. and other things, and, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. They go to, Butari or Sogo, Isai, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And get their students. They take them for internships, practical training. Kids from KISS to go to technology companies. But there aren't enough companies to take them for internships. Mm-hmm. Now, if that becomes part and parcel
of the learning process,
then we'll get proper products. Mm-hmm.
The patience, Professor. The patience is probably what some of these companies may not have. They want to be in business. They want to compete. They don't have time, probably, to mm-hmm. say, I'm just going to take these ones to train them. Mm-hmm. Yet I want to produce. I want to compete with company X. Mm-hmm. So I'm looking for people who are qualified, skilled, able to do these things that I want to be done. So how do we balance that? The quest for performance versus the urge to train these people.
As you notice, I'm retired. Mm. I think it's up to you to advise the Ministry of Education mm-hmm. so that they rearrange the curriculum to include mm-hmm. components of practical training in mm-hmm. while they are still at the university.
But why didn't you do that when you are in your capacity?
I didn't have enough time.
Really?
Yeah.
What more time did you need to do that?
Okay, if maybe I had another 8 years to go, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Or whoever is there, really it doesn't have to be me, mm-hmm. whoever is there, has to think about incorporating practical training mm-hmm. in the curriculum. Mm-hmm. That's extremely important. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, there's also another factor, and we don't want to be too critical here.
Super. Mm-hmm.
There are institutions of higher learning, especially private ones, which churn out graduates. I'm on very dangerous ground. Slippery ground.
Keep going.
They teach sociology,
yes.
political science,
yes.
religion, civics, those soft things, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Because they want the university degree and get into civil service. Because that's the system.
Mm-hmm. So long as you have a degree.
As long as you have a degree. Mm. Now, as long as those institutions don't offer practice-oriented subjects, it becomes very difficult. That's why maybe public institutions put their emphasis on the science and technology, because government has set goals, mm-hmm. right? But you can't impose those goals on private institutions. Mm. They want revenue from a large number of students.
So you're trying to say that they are uncontrollable, unregulatable, that we cannot give them a policy and tell them, you know what, there's a roadmap, a framework of how we operate when it comes to higher learning institutions.
Okay.
Is that what you're trying to say?
Okay. Now, they have a point. Mm. They have a reason to exist. Mm-hmm. If you go to the United Kingdom, mm-hmm. you go to France, you go to the United States, right? You have universities that have large number of liberal arts students, mm. right? Mm. Like we have at our own private institutions, mm-hmm. right? Mm. Now, they can afford it. Right? They can afford to retrain their students after they graduate, right? They have open minds, they have learned how to learn. But we are in a hurry. Mm. We want people to start on the job, ready to do the job. Now, the private institutions here will say, okay, we look at the world around us. They produce a lot of, liberal arts students.
Yes.
And they do very well on the job. Mm. But then they have time where they can train them to do the job. Mm. Now, I was Twittering, as you know,
yes.
I go on Twitter and Facebook and all that. Mm. I was having a conversation with people who have gone to Harvard and other institutions of higher learning, right? Mm-hmm. And studied English literature. They specialize in Chaucer or Shakespeare and all that. Mm. When they graduate, because they are very sharp, very intelligent students, right? Mm-hmm. They've learned how to learn. They go to companies on Wall Street and do extremely well mm-hmm. as traders on the stock market, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. That's something that they don't learn in college.
In college.
Right?
Yes.
But we, in a microcosm in Africa and the developing countries, we are in a hurry, we are trying to catch up. And we need practical skills more than we need the liberal arts and the time to retrain students, however intelligent and sharp they are. Mm.
The good news is that the education market has opened up in Rwanda specifically.
Right.
Mm. We've seen the coming in of other universities from the region and of course even international universities mm. coming to offer higher education in the country. Mm-hmm. So where do you see this putting the local institutions, the local higher learning institutions?
I really don't think there's any danger in that. Mm. One of the best universities in the world, Carnegie Mellon University, mm-hmm. is here, mm-hmm. teaching engineering, teaching IT, teaching management at the postgraduate level, mm-hmm. right? Mm. They offer no competition to our universities, because Rwandese students go to that institution and get the same quality of education as they would get in the United States. Mm-hmm. And Carnegie Mellon University is one of the best universities in the world, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And if it is here, and our students are going there, and they've graduated from there, mm. it's a fantastic opportunity.
It is.
Now, mm-hmm. remember, when you send one student to the United States, one student for 1 year, it costs this country $100,000 plus for that one student.
Until graduation.
Right. No, that's every year mm-hmm. for about 4 or 5 years. If they go to graduate school, it's even more, right? Mm-hmm. So bring that education here is much cheaper for the country. Mm-hmm. It's much more affordable than if they went down to Pittsburgh mm-hmm. or Harvard or Northern California or something like that, right? So it's a question of economics also, right? Now, take maybe you are hopping on Kenyan institutions. That's the ones they complain about mostly.
Why do you think they complain? Maybe they have they've come to you in your office during your tenure and said, you know what, as the person who's on top of you, we seem to have a problem with these people. What reasons do they give?
No.
Yes.
One problem is that they are raising the bar.
And they're fearing the raising of the bar? Is this what those who complain are afraid of?
That's part of it.
Really?
That's part of it. Mm. But there is, you know, here in Kichukiro, you have an institution called Jomo Kenyatta University of Agriculture and Engineering. It's offering agriculture and engineering
courses. Yes.
Right? Mm. That's something that we don't have here. And they are bringing graduate programs as well. So they are not competing with anybody.
Everybody has their own market.
They are not taking anyone's space, right? Mm. They are building, you know, they are putting infrastructure on the ground. So we are making, you know, I think it's profitable for us and for them too.
True.
Right?
So TVET, you know, has been given more emphasis. We've heard about this and we've seen a lot of campaign, you know, being done even at national level, encouraging people not to just only focus on going to, you know, universities or those who can't afford, but then they can take advantage of the TVET programs that we're having. Do you feel that this is the solution to the unemployment issue that we continue to see today, vis-a-vis the issue of lack of funds to go to, you know, universities?
Now, another caveat. I'm not an expert in TVET. So commenting on that might be dangerous for me.
You don't want I
don't step on people's toes, right? At the same time, you know, every time you call a plumber to your house, you know how much it costs you?
It's relative. You're comparing to what?
Every time. I've been, you know, trying to build a house. And, you know, builders, they take an enormous amount of money from you. Builders make a lot of money. I know, because my son-in-law is a builder. In Chicago, he does extremely well. So if you're a builder, you're a carpenter, you're a plumber, electrician, those are necessary skills. It's like food, like being a nurse or curing people and all that. They are essential skills, right? So you are always going to be employable, right? Now, as you said, maybe that's a solution. But at the same time, we have a problem. We have the problem that people have here, or maybe all over East Africa, that you only demonstrate success if you're wearing a jacket,
and a tie, yes.
Or sit in an easy chair like this, right? In an office. Because that is what they saw as a successful person during colonial times.
So we're always running for the white-collar jobs.
White-collar jobs, you said it well, right? So TVET is practical, hands-on, dirt training. Brings in money.
And this is where you advise that young person who's listening and has not been able to get this white-collar job to put their eyes on.
Now, they also have to... It's not just the problem of the student. There has to be a change of, you know, there has to be a rethinking in the government so that the civil service has a different attitude to TVET graduates. So that if they are integrated in the system of education, right, they can be competitive salary-wise with people with BAs, right? So you come down from up the hill with a sociology degree. You get a job in the civil service. You get a certificate in plumbing or an electrician or an engineer at a lower level, you can't get a job in the civil service or get promoted at the same rate.
Because you're from TVET.
You don't have the bachelor's degree, that kind of thing. So there has to be a change of perception.
Right, right.
So TVET, that orientation, there are models of countries that have been extremely successful.
Going through that direction.
Yeah. For instance, you know, Singapore is an example. They give people practical skills. And those people have a way of advancing higher, right? You can start in a two-year program or a one-year program, and then you get on the job, you get promoted, you take steps until you get to a college degree, right? But you have also the practical training that you got on the job, right? Germany is a fantastic example of a successful country that has an orientation towards practical skills.
We have so many good examples, so many points of reference, Professor, but then one would wonder why then have we, or why are we taking long to probably pick a model and maybe run with that? And maybe as you answer this, I'd probably like you to tell us here, even also during your tenure, do you have a decision that you had to make that you feel today you look back and you feel that was an unpopular decision that I made?
Unpopular? In the accreditation process, there are some unpopular things that you have to do. In the accreditation process, you have to make a recommendation after reviewing an institution according to the guidelines.
Yes.
You have to make a recommendation to your board, and the board makes a recommendation to the minister, right? Who makes a recommendation to the cabinet?
Yes.
For accreditation. Now, you may make, a conclusion that people don't
really
want to hear.
Feel like it was necessary or good.
Right. So, for instance, if you tell us, you indicate in your recommendation, this institution is not up to par, right? Hasn't met the standards, right? So they should wait before they get accreditation. Or if they are accredited already, you withdraw the accreditation. That is the hard part of the job.
Did you ever find such situation? And is there any situation you feel like you want to regret?
No, I'm not going to name names here. I want to retire peacefully.
And I want to have you around peacefully and also more often, of course. So, yes.
It happened in one or two cases. One institution, right, couldn't get accredited, and we said they should catch up before they apply again. In another institution, it took longer than they wanted, right? So those things are part of the territory.
Of the territory.
Yeah, part of the job.
So you have no regrets for every decision you made during your time?
Actually, to be perfectly truthful, I was not a decision maker. I had a board of directors, and it was supervised by the minister. So we made recommendations.
Okay.
So the decision makers
decided to make the decision.
Right.
So
we are sort of technical people, right? That's what the Higher Education Council is. It's like being an auditor. An auditor makes findings, makes recommendations, and passes them on.
So no regrets at all for whatever your team did during your time?
Well, my regret is that maybe I didn't have time to sort of, complete whatever I wanted to complete.
But you can do that through the ones who are there right now, can you? And through recommendation, you can still do that through the ones who are now there.
No.
You can't even advise.
But listen. If you leave a job.
You just leave.
If you leave a job and continue to advise those people you left in that previous job, you don't want to cause any resentment, right? So leave and let alone, right? Operate the way they can, the way they will, right? And I think the people we left in place are doing a very good job.
All right. It is time to leave. Thank you so much, Professor Rujeje, for being with us on One-on-One.
Thank you so very much for inviting
me. And it's quite an honor having you around, and we hope to have you here more often than not. And of course, we wish you all the best as you enjoy your retirement.
That was a real half hour.
Just like that.
Went quickly, yeah.
Yes, thank you so much. There you
thank
have
you
it.
Very much for inviting me. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Professor Rujeje right here with us, of course, giving you the wise words concerning higher learning institutions in the country. Take away those important points that you feel you need to do, especially if you are involved in this kind of particular sector. The discussions just like this and even more are just going to be here on 89.7 Contact FM and on Contact TV via our application C24. From me and the team, it's a wrap. I'm Eugene Anangwe. Goodbye.